grace beyond anything you can imagine. Praise God. You may be seated. 10:19. Won't it be right there? Hallelujah. And yes, it will. The answer to that is yes. Oh, when with the Savior we enter that lonely land, won't it be wonderful there?
By the self-same winds that blow.
'Tis the set of the sails and not the gales that tells the way we go. Like the winds of the sea and the waves of time as we journey along through life, 'tis the set of the soul that determines the goal and not the calm or the strife. I want to talk to us about tonight and maybe next week also. I'm going to be talking about four things in particular. One is about priorities. Then we're going to talk about time. We're going to talk about our thoughts. And we're going to talk about growing. And you may say, how are those four things all related? But they are. They are all so much related. And they are four things that are going to make all the difference in the world where you're going to end up and what the results of your life and my life will be. Amen. I've mentioned before, I've been to a lot of high school graduations and I've been to college graduations and Bible school graduations. And one thing I've noticed, I've never been to a high school graduation or any other graduation where all the students speaking and teachers speaking get up and say, well, we realize that some of you are going to make some dumb mistakes and 5 years from now there'll be some of you that'll be dead because you had a stupid accident. Or you got involved in alcohol or drugs. Or you got involved in a relationship with someone that was an idiot. You got yourself killed because you were foolish. And we realize that there may be a few out of you that will be very successful in life. And then there'll be some of you that will just get along and be okay. And then there's a fair-sized percentage of you that will struggle through life and some will never amount to nothing. I've never heard a graduation where they said things like that. It was always, we're going to go and change the world. They call themselves the world changers. The generation that's going to straighten out everything that every generation in the history of the world messed up. We're going to be the ones that are all super successful. And they could be. Every one of them could be. Every one of them has the potential to be. You know, if you're standing on the street corner and there's a business executive drives by in a beautiful automobile wearing a nice suit, and on that same street corner is someone laying there, sleeps on the street at night under a cardboard box, gets out and rummages through the trash to find food, you know what the difference between those two people almost always amounts to? It's almost never because one is so much smarter than the other. It's almost never a result of because of one had more ability than the other. And most of the time it has nothing to do with how much money their family had. You're as likely to see someone on that street corner living in a cardboard box who was born into a good home with a family that lived in a nice house and was doing well as you are someone whose family was poor. The difference is how they spent their time. There are people. We have a gentleman that's become the head of housing and urban development in America, Dr. Carson. He was running for president. He was such a nice guy. And in American politics, it's such a nasty thing right now. And he was too nice a guy to fight back against all of them, and they ate him alive. But he is such a compassionate man, and he will be, he is a phenomenal leader. That man grew up a son of a single mother who grew up in a very abusive home. His mother was the child of sharecroppers, the poorest of the poor. Alcoholics on drugs. His mom only had a third grade education. But she said, my kids are not going to live a life like I have had to live. She required her kids to read two books every week and write, give her a cult report. Every week, they had to turn in a book report to her, and she would mark marks on it and different things, and they did not know until they were almost ready to graduate from high school, their mother could not read. She, her son got in a lot of trouble, was running with the wrong crowd, and she sat him down and said, I did not raise you to be like this. I expect more out of you than this. You have the ability to excel if you'll do it. And his mom's faith in him and strictness and insistence began to speak to his heart. And he started digging in and studying, and he became the head surgeon. Brain surgeon at John Hopkins Medical Center, which is one of the most famous medical centers on earth. He became the head doctor over the Department of Neurology. He developed new methods and ways of operating on the human brain that no one had ever discovered before, that revolutionized brain surgery. Affected the entire world. There are many thousands of people walking around alive today in good health that would not be alive had he not become what he did. Started out life the poorest of the poor. They didn't even own a home. They were on the streets for a while. Had to move in with relatives. Their relatives didn't even want them there. And that was obvious. Amen. Nobody could have come from a much worse background. But you see, when he began to spend his time in a certain way, it brought certain results. It brought certain results. The Bible talks a lot about priorities. It really talks a lot about priorities. And we started with that last week. I want to mention two individuals that were so focused on priorities for their life. And I think the fact that they were so focused on what is the highest priority for them above everything else. And the results that brought, I think that ought to speak to our hearts. One, you'll find in Psalm 27, David, who eventually became the king of Israel, told us that he had one goal in life. There was one thing he wanted, and only thing he said that he was asking God for. He said this one thing. Psalm 27, verse 4. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. I'm not just saying, Lord, I'd like to have this. I am after this. I am passionate about it. I am focused on it. I am going to get it because I'm going after it with everything I got. One thing in his temple. I'm not in this thing to live for God for a little while and then be somewhere else. I'm not in it to impress people and to make some name for myself. I'm not in it to show what I think I am or ought to be. I want to be in the house of God all the days of my life. I want to be living for God 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. The Lord grants me 50 more years or 60 more years. Amen. Or 70 more years. I don't think the church is going to be here that long. But if they were and he granted me that long, I would still want to be living for God. I can tell you of saints that I've known. There have been saints that have been here. Some of them came from some really bad backgrounds. We've had people came that preachers in other places told them they were demon-possessed and they were not demon-possessed. And people have tried to cast devils out of them, and they had shamed them and isolated them and scorned them, and they go to the house of God and found no comfort, no friendship, no fellowship, no kindness. They were treated horrible. And they had severe emotional problems. But God brought them here, and we saw God heal them. And they're living for God today. They're living for God today. I can tell you others who came. One young man, his dad was a district superintendent, a great man of God. Today, he and his wife were both as backslid as they could be. They never put their heart in living for God. They were always going to do it their way. We preach from the Word of God, and they'd say, well, I don't think that's necessary. And today, they don't think anything's necessary. And their lives are a total mess. They're not even living for God. Amen. I can tell you a preacher. Amen. Over the years, I've known preachers to preach conferences. And 5, 10, 15 years later, they're not even in the truth. Amen. Brother Yoko Young was talking to me about someone the other day and said he had heard some things about that person. I said, yes, that's true. That's true. It's very, very sad. Amen. The person's gone as crazy as can be. Divorced his wife. Messed up. Oh, he was a very famous conference preacher. Today he is as crazy. Goes around trying to tell everybody he's an apostle. He started a fellowship of apostles, and he don't care what you preach, just as long as you say you're an apostle. It's a mess. Amen. David said, I want to be living for God 5 years from now. 10 years, 20 years, as long as God grants me life, I still want to be in the house of God. I still want to be there with a hunger for God. I want to be there coming to his house to behold the beauty of the Lord. Not to come in and find fault and criticize. Yeah. But to come and behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple, Lord, what would you have me to do? Amen. I'm in this thing to stay. That was David's desire. He said in one place, I hate the work of them that turn aside. He said, there's somebody was my close friend. We went to church together. We used to go to the house of God together. And then, for some reason, they decided they were my enemy. And they were praying God would kill me. When I got sick, they let everybody know they hoped I'd die. Wow. And he said, I've never done any. When they were sick, I fasted for them. I prayed for them. When I got sick, they said, see there, God's forsaken him. God's judging him. God's going to destroy him. Amen. He said, that was my sweet friend. But I look where he's at today. And because of his attitude, he's going to reap the very things he's hoping on me. Amen. David said, I want to keep living for God. I want to keep living for God. The Apostle Paul in Philippians chapter 3 said, I've got something, one thing I want, one thing. David said, one thing I desire of the Lord, that will I seek after. Paul said, there's one thing I'm seeking God for. I want you to notice the priority. Priority. This was a priority in their life. It was ahead of everything else. You know, there's things the Bible says, seek this first. Seek this first. Do this first. That's establishing a priority. It's establishing a priority of importance. This is more important than other things. It's also establishing a priority of focus, where we need to focus our attention and put our energy. It's also establishing a priority of time, that we need to do this before we worry about doing other things. And if we don't have time to do other things, we need to make sure we take time to do this.
Yeah.
But. Amen. In Philippians chapter 3, the Apostle Paul told how he had lost everything and counted the dung to win Christ. Amen. That's up to verse 8. Verse 9, to be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. I want to live for God and receive righteousness from him because of my faith in him, not because I'm so perfect in myself, but because I'm looking to the Lord for help, that I may know him. Notice this. This is what I want. I want to know him. And the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. I want to know the Lord. I want to know the power of his resurrection working in my life. He died, was buried, and rose from the grave for me so that his power could work in my life. I want that working in my life. Amen. And the fellowship of his sufferings. I want to be willing to suffer and to become like Christ. And to be made conformable unto his death. I look at him as he gave his life, loving people that were mocking him, and yet he loved them even while they were mocking him and forgave them. And I want to learn how to be that kind of a person. If by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead, not as though I had already attained it and were already perfect, but I follow after it that I may apprehend that which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Something got a hold of me, and now I'm trying to get a hold of it. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended. Notice this, but this one thing I do. Everybody say, this one thing I do. Say it with a little more enthusiasm, please. This together. This one thing I do. Let's say it again. This one thing I do. Is there one thing that you do and you will not allow to be undone in your life and walk with God? That it absolutely comes before everything else, and if nothing else gets done, this gets done. There's one thing I do. Amen. Forgetting those things which are behind, I can't change them. I wish I could. There are things I wish I could go back and do over and do different, but I can't. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. There's still, okay, I can sit around and feel bad about all the missed opportunities of the past and failures of the past, but that's not going to help me for the future. I've got to put that under the blood and say, I can't change what the past was. I can ask God to forgive me or thank God for the victories, but that's done. But the time to come, the future, the days I still have, I can do something about that. And I have to do something about it. I've got to make those days better. I've got to use them more carefully, more wisely. I cannot waste them. One thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. He said, there is a place that God is calling me to, and I'm not there. But I am trying as hard as I can to get there. I know it's where God wants me to be. It's a high calling He has called me to, in relationship with Him and being used of Him. And I haven't even come close to it yet. But I've got to get there. I've got to get there. And that was His attitude. Notice His priority, His focus. It was a very focused, one desire. One desire. Whatever I've got to do, I've got to get there to the high calling, the place God's calling me to be, to what God's calling me, where He wants to use me. I've got to give whatever I can do, and with God's help, I've got to get there. Amen. Too many times, we don't have any focus. We're not trying to go anywhere, really. Just trying to live life day by day and get through another day. And that's why we're not going anywhere. We don't, if we're not trying to move forward, we won't move forward. Priorities are so important. Priorities. Amen. Just one thing. David had a priority. I want to make sure I'm living for God. I can tell you some names of people and preachers. The one time, we were so thrilled by them. We thought they were wonderful, but today they're not even really living for God. They're totally off the post doctrine. Their lives are a mess. Amen. They're not walking with God in righteousness at all. They mock and make fun of what the Bible tells us how to live as a holy and godly life. They don't think that the Acts 2:38 message is necessary for salvation. They can't even tell you what they think if anybody calls himself a Christian. Even though the Bible absolutely says that's a lie, they think if they call themselves a Christian, they're probably okay. Friend, that is as false doctrine. And some of them don't think it matters that much if you live immoral, divorce your wife, and run around with other women. And one time they preached the gospel, and I can tell you there are other preachers that I could mention their names that have come here to Japan and preached, and they are as straight and strong living for God today as they ever were, in fact, more than they ever were before. And they have moved forward, and they're into a new, deeper area being used of God, and a deeper walk and a more humble walk. And God's hand is on them more than it ever was. And they're not trying to be a showboat superstar. They're just so hungry for God. Amen. Help them live for God. Praise God. Amen. Oh, I don't want to be a 90-day wonder. It just really, it's like a shooting star, and the next thing you know, it's gone out. Where is it? And I've seen those more times than I can tell over the years at Pentecost growing up. But I can tell you others that have walked with God consistently. They haven't always been the big names and the superstars. But they have been there day after day, year after year. Year after year. Being used of God, building something solid, something that lasts. Amen. I've seen people build real big things. I remember a preacher that took a church, and in a short time it went from averaging 200, about 250 or 300, maybe 350, up to over 1,000. And then he was so busy with all the big projects he was trying to operate. He didn't have time to pray and time to walk with God. And then he got caught in an immoral situation, messed up situation. Today he's not a minister. Today he's backslid. Today his family's busted up. Today he's a stinking sinner. And then that church broke up and it went down for a while. And now it's up running around 225, 250 again. Amen. I look at other churches that have just consistently, year after year, sometimes they grow by 3 a year, sometimes 5 a year, sometimes times 10 a year. But they've been doing that for 25 years, 30 years. Just steadily moving forward, growing. I can tell you others that have grown more and faster. People that come to the Lord, ministers trained, going out, starting churches other places. But they just kept walking with God consistently, reaching for God. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Raising their kids and the kids that grow up in their church to live for God. What a wonderful thing. Praise God. We started last week talking about 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12 through 14. Take heed. Paul told Timothy, take heed to yourself and unto the doctrine. Amen. Was 1 Timothy chapter 4. You said, till I come? Give attendance to reading. We said, let no man despise thy youth, but be an example of the believers in word and conversation and charity and spirit and faith and purity. Till I come, give attendance to reading, exhortation to doctrine. Notice, this is things he's doing. He's supposed to do. Paul's telling you, you need to be doing this. You need to be reading. You need to be reaching out to others. And don't just talk.
Okay.
Say something that you got from God, that you heard and learned from God in studying His Word and in prayer. And in doctrine, neglect not the gifts in thee, which was given thee by prophecy with laying on of the hands of the presbytery. It's not enough to have been given a gift from God. You got to do something with it. Meditate upon these things.
Amen.
Give thyself wholly to them. This is a total commitment. That thy prophecy may appear to all. Take heed unto thyself. There's some that have messed up because they didn't take heed to themselves. They didn't maintain their own walk with God. And unto the doctrine. Others have messed up because they didn't really dig in and have a hunger and a love for the Word of God. And so gradually that really big numbers became, and popularity became more important. Getting money and things became more important than preaching truth and living truth. But friend, we better love truth above popularity, money, or anything else. We better, because God is true. His Word is true. We better love the truth with everything in us. If we're not built on the truth, we have no foundation. Amen. Take heed of thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them for in doing this, thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. Oh, friend, I want to be saved, and I want those that God allows me to work with to be saved. To be saved. Amen. We looked at Proverbs chapter 4. I'd like to turn there very quickly. Proverbs chapter 4. This is talking about priorities in your life. Paul told Timothy, you need to make this a priority. Take heed to yourself. Take heed to the doctrine. Be an example. Live right. Do right. God gave you some gifts. Don't just let them lie. You're busy. Try to grow in your walk with God and be used of God. Amen. Proverbs chapter 4. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You said, keep your heart with all diligence. This is really important. With all diligence means this is a priority. This is big stuff. This, and he says, we're out of it are the issues of life. Everything that happens in your life is going to be something that flows out of your heart. So if things are not right in your heart, if your desires are not right, if your focus is not right, if your hungers are not right, then everything that flows out of you is going to be messed up. But if you get your heart right, then everything that flows out of that is going to be something wonderful. Praise God. Keep thy heart with all diligence. For out of the issues of life, put away from the forward mouth. The verse slips. Put far from thee. Be careful how you talk. Don't just be foolish in how you talk. How you talk is important. Let thine eyes look right on. Keep your focus. Don't lose your direction. Keep your focus. Let thine eyes look right on. Keep thine eyes look straight before thee. You got to be focused. You got to think about, where am I going? Where am I set taking me? Is that where I want to go? If I'm going to get where I want to go, where I need to go, what do I need to do? You need to pay attention, because your steps are taking you somewhere. Ponder the path of thy feet, and let all thy ways be established. Turn not to the right or to the left. Remove thy foot from evil. Amen. All of us are moving in a direction, either closer to God or further away. Either more in love with truth or further away. If you used to love truth more than you do now, friend, you better turn around and get headed back toward truth. If you used that hunger for God more than you do now, you need to turn around and refocus and make the desire for God the greatest, most important thing in your life. Amen. It's life. It's everything. Praise God. Our life here is so short, but eternity is so long. Praise the Lord. Keep thy heart. Keep thy heart. Keep thy heart. Keep thy heart. We mentioned, I ought to be writing these verses down. I apologize. So, Psalm 27. Verse 4, one thing have I desired the Lord. Philippians chapter 3, this was Paul, that was David. Chapter 3 is the 13 and 14, I believe it is. We actually started reading about verse 8 in Philippians 3. And then 1 Timothy 4, 12 through 16. And in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23 through 27. These all have to do with priorities in our life and focus. Now he just said, keep your heart with all diligence. Turn with me to Jeremiah chapter 17. Jeremiah chapter 17. I should have put down Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. That means this has got to be the most important thing to you. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. It's got to be where you're focused at. You're focusing on trying to seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness. It's also where you're giving your time. Because if I'm not giving my time toward seeking first, if I'm not putting the kingdom of God and his righteousness first in my time, I'm not obeying that scripture. If I don't put it in first in my priorities, first my time, my energy, my focus, then I'm not doing what Jesus said. I'm disobedient to the Lord. I'm breaking his command. He said, and I want you to know, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness is just as much a command from God as thou shalt honor, thou shalt have no idols, thou shalt make no graven images, thou shalt not lie. This is a command of the Lord, just as important as any other command. And in fact, this is a bit more than many, because he said, seek this first. Put this first. When he says, seek first, either I do seek first or I don't seek first. Either I'm doing it or I'm not. If I'm not seeking it first, I'm not obeying him. I'm disobeying him. I'm not doing what he said. I'm not obeying him. I'm just doing whatever I want. But if I put this first, and this is where I put my focus, and I give this time, then I'm obeying him. Amen. In Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9 through 10. If someone can stand and read that, if you have it. Jeremiah 17, 9 through 10.
Jeremiah heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it?
Wow.
I, the Lord, set the heart and cry reins even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his goings.
He says the heart. Everybody say my heart.
My heart.
Come on, everybody say my heart.
My heart.
It's not just your heart is deceitful. When he says the heart, he's talking about your heart, my heart, and everybody else's heart. Right? Is that true? The heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. And who could know it? He says, I, the Lord, that try the heart. Try the reins. When he's talking about the reins, he's talking about what is directing us, causing us to do what we are doing. Amen. I search the heart, I try the reins to give every man according to his ways. Not according to what he says are his ways, but according to what he actually does. God's not going to reward us for what we said we'd like to do. He's going to reward us for what we actually did or did not do. When he says, seek first the kingdom of God, that is an instruction from the master of the house to us, the servants. He's telling us, here's what I want you to put first. Amen. Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. I'm going to take a moment to do this because it's so important. And then we'll end with this for tonight. And we may have to come back. If I don't have time to comment much on it, then we'll come back and take this up from here next week, perhaps. The Lord willing. Colossians chapter 3. If you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth, for you are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. Okay, I was going to do the whole chapter, but we're just going to do these first three verses tonight, and then we'll start back there next week. But I want you to notice, he says, set your affection. Set your affection. Do you know, there are people who talk about falling in love or falling out of love, but that's not even possible. They set their affections on a certain person or on a certain thing. I've noticed that people who fall in love find it just as easy to fall out of love. Love is not something you fall in or fall out of. It's a direction you set your heart. What it is, they imagine in their mind that person is a certain way and a certain thing, and so they say, oh, I've fallen in love with them. It just happened to me, I fell in love. Then after they are around them a little while, they find out that person's not exactly like they thought they were. And since their idea was a dream and that other person is real, I'm going to tell you, a flesh and blood person cannot compete with a dream. Flesh and blood people are real. They have good days and bad days. Amen. I don't care who the girl is and how beautiful her hair is. And she gets up in the morning and it's not freshly combed. And it's not beautiful, long, flowing. When she wakes up first thing in the morning, it's like a rat's nest sometimes. And I don't care how much perfume she wears and how sweet she smells. Sometimes she wakes up in the morning, she got bad breath. People are, you know, they're real. They're not a dream, they're real. Amen. And so somebody decides that the real person is not what they were dreaming of, so then they both fall out of love. The Bible says, set your affection. passion. It means make up your mind. This is where what I'm going to love. This is what I want. This is what I desire. This is what I hunger for. This is what I'm reaching for.
Amen.
Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For you're dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. Amen. And then the rest of that chapter talks about that. Remember, the heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. So he says, you need to set your affection. If it's not something you can do, he wouldn't tell you to do it. The fact he tells you to do it means you have the ability to do it. You can choose to do it. Set your affections on things above. Make up your mind. What I'm hungry for is the things of God. What I'm hungry for is to please God. What I'm hungry for is to do the will of God. What I want in life is that relationship with the Lord. I want to walk with Him. I want to talk with Him. I want to hear His voice. I want the leading of the presence of God in my life. I got to have that. Amen. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. Sister Lucas, could you come? And when you turn in your hymn book, we're going to sing a song in closing tonight. Maybe you'd like to stand. We've been singing for a bit. And, amen. You come on Bible study night, a lot of times you're really tired. And so I don't like to keep you standing too much. Sometimes I'm guilty of that, but I try to be careful. Amen. But if you turn to hymn 22 in your hymn book. And these.